Happy Sabbath, everyone.
Happy Sabbath, Willis.
Now, could you turn that up to 55, please? To some of you, this is probably
It's on.
Very familiar story. You might have heard recently a sermon on this topic. But this is the only one that I could find that touches on an issue that's affecting us in our world today. It's affecting religion, and it's affecting many different areas in our world. Many are confused in regards to who's a Jew, who's not a Jew, what's anti-Semitism, and all these things. And I think the Bible clears all of this up. So we're going to talk a little bit about that this morning. We're not going to go into all details about everything, but we're going to touch on some things. Before we do that, let us bow our heads for prayer. Father in heaven, I'm just a vessel to be used. Please use me. I'm no different from anyone else. I pray, Father, that all who are here, that you would help them to stay awake so that they may hear what you have to say today. And I pray, Father, that it may help them, not only help them, but also help others as they share with them. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
The title of my message this morning is Living Water. And I'm coming from the book of John, chapter 4. John, chapter 4. It says in John, chapter 4, verses 1, when therefore the Lord knew how the Pharisees had heard that Jesus made and baptized more disciples than John, though Jesus himself baptized but his disciples. Verse 3 says, he left Judea and departed again into Galilee. And he must needs go through Samaria. Then cometh he to the city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near to the parcel of the ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Samaria. This was a place where the Samaritans dwelled. But who are the Samaritans? After the death of Solomon, the nation of Israel became divided. There were 12 tribes that made up the Hebrew nation. There were new kings who came on the scene. One king had 10 tribes, and one king had 2 tribes. King Jeroboam ruled in the north. And Rehoboam ruled in the south. Rehoboam, Solomon's son, anointed successor, ruled over the southern kingdom, which was composed of 2 tribes, Judah and Benjamin. Jeroboam, on the other hand, ruled over 10 tribes, Asher, Dan, Ephraim, Gad, Issachar, Manasseh, Naphtali, Reuben, Simon, and Zebulun. All these were sons or grandsons of Jacob. King Jeroboam ruled over the north. The capital city of the northern kingdom was established first in Shechem and later in Samaria, both of which cities were located in the territory of the tribe of Ephraim. Sometimes the names of these cities were used to mean the whole of the northern kingdom. Jeroboam established a state religion of adulterous worship. The new nation never repented of their wickedness, which contributed to its downfall. Historians tell us that 20 monarchs ruled the Northern Kingdom from its beginning until its destruction by the Assyrians. Five different family dynasties were set up in the Northern Kingdom, but all were short-lived and all ended by assassination or violence. This was the Northern Kingdom. In 721 BC, the Assyrians came down and invaded the Northern Kingdom. The people of Israel that survived intermingled and intermarried with the Assyrian people. They were considered no longer pure, no longer considered a pure bloodline. Even their teachings were different. These people later became known as the Samaritans. They practiced the Torah, the five books of the Bible, but they also practiced idol worship. In James 2, 17:33 says, they feared the Lord and served their own gods after the manner of nations whom they carried, the manner of nations whom they carried away from thence. So these nations carried them away and they served other gods. But it also says they feared the Lord. Is it possible to fear the Lord and also serve other gods?
No.
Well, there's a mixture here of good and evil. You got God's religion, and then you have the pagan religion. You know, when you look back in history, you see a lot of this. A lot of people or Jews or those who were followers of Christ or Hebrews, when they were invaded or when they went into captivity, they took on the other religion but also kept the Hebrew religion. In history, they call these people crypto-Jews.
Crypto-Jews.
Don't get it confused with cryptocurrency. Crypto simply means hidden. The group became identified as crypto-Jews. They were, when they were invaded, I would say in modern times, when they were invaded, the Jews were invaded. They were invaded by Europeans, and the Europeans brought their religion. And so these Jews, in public, they were Catholics. But behind the scenes, when they went home, they were Jews. When you look at the history of the world in the 1400s, you see this all through the history. In this woman's case, in the open, she was an Assyrian, but at home, she was a Jew. The woman comes to the well, and she sees Jesus there. Now, technically, when you look at this situation, I've heard many say that this woman was a Jew. This woman was a Samaritan, and where were the Samaritans? Which tribe did they belong to? Which group when there was separation? Was it the 10 tribes or the 2 tribes? This woman did not come from the tribe of Judah. So technically, she wasn't really a Jew in a true sense of the word. Now let me explain, because I know some of you probably think I'm losing it right now. When you look at this word Jew, people have to get an understanding of the word. You see, in the 1500s and the 1600s, there was, when you look at the alphabet before then, there was no letter J. And then the 1500s, A priest was experimenting with the letter. It wasn't really called an I then, but it looked like an I, and he added a hook on it, and that's where you got the J. And so before the 1500s, there were no Jews, so to speak. When we look at the name Jesus, if you say, wait a minute, and many of people are saying this, they said, wait a minute, if there were no Jews and there was no Jesus. No. Jesus is the same person. Names change, but the same person. And you would find that many names in translation from Rome or Latin to English to whatever, names change, same people. Jesus was known as Emmanuel, which means God with us. But when you look up his name, you go back further and look up his name, it's spelled I-E-S-O-U-S. It's pronounced Jesus. And so what happened when the J came in, they dropped the I, added the J, took out the O, and you have Jesus. And instead of Hebrews or referring to Judah, because the word Jews refers to the tribe of Judah, it doesn't refer to the other 10 tribes. So when you actually say Jews, you're really talking about the tribe of Judah and Benjamin. Jesus was also called several other names. He was called teacher, master, rabbi, other names. Isaiah 7:13-15 says, and he said, hear ye now, O house of David, is it a small thing for you to weary men? But will ye weary my God also? Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. It also says this in Matthew 1:23. Behold, a virgin shall be with child and shall bring forth, and they shall call his name Emmanuel. Here, Emmanuel is spelled with an E and not an I, but it still says or means the same thing, God with us. The J points to Judah. So in this story, when you look at this woman is not technically a Jew, but she's part of the Hebrew family that were caught in captivity, began to intermarry, and begin to take on the worship of the Samaritans. The leaders of the tribe of Judah had a problem with this. They looked at those Jews as half-breeds, not pure, tainted. And so Jesus is going to the well. He's at the well. The woman approaches Jesus, and all this, in a sense, is in the background. There's a term used for these Jews, and it's a very negative term, and it's called Moranos. You know what a Morano is? A Morano, a Jew who converted to the Christian faith, which was Roman Catholic faith at the time, to escape persecution, but who continued to practice Judaism secretly. It was a term of abuse and also applies to the descendants of the Moranos. The world is confused today when you use that term Jews. They think you're talking about the 12 tribes. But we see here that this woman was not part of the two, which when you look at the two, you see Judah, and that's where they get the term Jews from. The tribe of Judah had a problem dealing with these Samaritans, but they would only deal with them when it benefited them financially or business-wise. Now, today we have a problem also with this. The world, when you say the word Jew or say anything bad about a Jew, the world comes down on you. People are losing money and jobs. It's a cancel culture. They cancel you. There's another element, though, that was put into this situation. Color. Now you have people on both sides, some white, some black, saying they're Jews, and some of the whites don't accept the blacks, and some of the blacks don't accept the whites. It's a mess. As a Protestant Christian, we think we have problems, but they really have problems. We all come from Adam and Eve, Noah's family. We are all descendants from one part of the world. And we should all treat everybody the same. But here what we see in the story with Jesus and this woman, that her and her people were not treated the same. 2 Chronicles 7:14 says, if my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and I will forgive their sins and will heal their land. This is God's promise to us. The Bible tells us in the last days in Matthew 24:7 and Mark 13:8 and also in Luke 21:10, it says, the nation shall rise against nation, and when you look at that word and the interpreted word, it's race against race. If you've lived in the world long enough, you'll realize that all kinfolk ain't skinfolk. And that in-laws can quickly and immediately become outlaws. But God's people are called to love. Not only God, not only their neighbor, but also their enemies. We see Jews today, or those who claim to be Jews, who are standing up and say they are the Jews. What we see is a lot of people hating people. So that's the backdrop. Now let's get into the sermon. Verse 6. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied with his journey, sat thus on the well, and it was about the sixth hour, which is about 12 o'clock. Verse 7. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, give me a drink. Now, verse 8 says the disciples were not there. And so is Jesus here with this woman? Verse 9 says, then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which I am a Samaritan woman? The Jews, or those who from the tribe of Judah, should not have any contact or relationship with those of Samaria. It says, for the Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. Here the woman actually appears shocked. How is this man who is a Jew talking to me? And he's asking her for water. Jesus is from the tribe of Judah. He's a Jew. The Jews normally did not associate with Samaritans. In some countries, this could be trouble if you talk to a woman that you don't know. Jesus was breaking from the norm by talking to this woman. Why was he doing this? He did this because this was important. More important than any man-made law or any man-made tradition. Don't get me wrong. Or don't get Jesus wrong. There's nothing wrong with tradition. And there's nothing wrong with man-made laws, as long as man-made laws and traditions are not put over God's laws.
Amen.
Jesus answers and said to her, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou would have asked him, and he would have given thee living water. You know, when I think of water, I think of many things. And when I think of what water does, isn't that living water? Water that makes up 60 to 70% of the human body. Water lubricates the joints. Water that prevents dehydration and helps to maximize energy. Water that helps the body to throw off waste. Water, it helps to form saliva and mucus, which helps to keep your eyes and nose and lips moist. Water cleans the teeth and keeps the breath smelling fresh. Water, which cleanses the skin and keeps it bouncy. It cushions the brain and the spinal cord and other sensitive tissues. It delivers oxygen throughout the body. It stimulates blood flow to the organs and the brain and the skin. It regulates the body temperature. It helps digestion. Scientists say 8 to 10 days without water, if you don't have it, you will die. Doesn't that sound like living water to you?
I think it's less than that.
But this is not what Jesus is talking about. Although water is important, the physical water, Jesus was talking about something different and something more powerful and important. Now, let's look at Jesus' approach. Jesus is an evangelist, the ultimate evangelist. Let's look at his witnessing approach. He gets past the cultural norms of discriminating against this Samaritan woman. He goes straight past the traditions of a man approaching a woman in public. He flies through the racial barriers as if they do not exist, and he asks the woman politely for a drink of water. Then he segues into his mission. He goes from water to water. He goes from literal water to talking about spiritual living water. A comedian once said, you don't want to have friends that are oversaved. You know those friends that go to extremes? You know those friends that every time you try to tell them about something, they put the Lord in it? They can't hold a regular conversation with folks. You will say something like, I'm thirsty. Are you thirsty? And they'll say, thirsty for the Lord. Or you will say something like, I lost my keys. Can you help me find my keys? And they'll say, keys to the kingdom. You know, sometimes the approach can scare people to death. But Jesus engaged in a normal conversation with this woman. Jesus' approach is different. Regular conversations are needed when you're witnessing for the Lord. Mm-hmm. The woman is very observant. Look at verse 11. The woman saith unto him, Sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From whence then hast thou that living water? Verse 12 says, Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well and drank thereof himself, and his children and his cattle? This woman knew the history of Israel, even though she was in a foreign land, she still knew the history of Jacob's well. Notice Jesus' approach. Jesus doesn't offer her something. I'm talking about evangelism. He doesn't offer her something first. What does he do? He asks for something. Jesus asks the woman for water. Then he segues into this conversation about living water. They begin to engage in a normal conversation. He befriends her, and then smoothly he makes his appeal. Often when we are witnessing, we offer something first, and the people feel like, I don't need anything. Perhaps if our approach is a little different, if we say, can you help me? Maybe they're willing to help us, and then we can help them. I was told years ago that what we do at evangelism, we'll give out a whole bunch of literature before the evangelist comes. And they said for every 1,000 pieces of literature, you're going to get one soul. That's a bad ratio. Perhaps the approach needs to change. Perhaps we should ask for something first. Perhaps someone has something that can meet our need, immediate need, that's not costly, and then we can meet their need. You know, many people today, when you try to give them something, they feel like, I have no need. I don't need that. You try to give them Jesus, oh, I have my own religion. Well, this is a book about history. No, I already know about the history. I don't need that. But Jesus asked the woman. And she, even though in spite of the barriers, she gave him water and he was able to engage in a normal conversation. Verse 13 says, Jesus answered and said unto her, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again, but whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give shall never thirst, but the water that I shall give shall be in him a well of water springing unto everlasting life. Notice what this woman says after Jesus says that. The woman said unto him, sir, give me this water that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw again. This woman wants the water. Suppose Jesus would have offered her this first. She would have probably felt a little uncomfortable. And I think sometimes when you look at the approach, people feel uncomfortable with the approach. What is living water? That's the question. Living water. All did drink of the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Jesus. Remember when Moses approached the rock and he strikes the rock? What comes out of the rock? Water. You know, the question is, when people ask the question, they said, what is this living water? I think it's not so much what is this living water, it's who is this living water? Who preceded Jesus? The Holy Spirit. All these debates that we see going on in our world today over who's a Jew and who's not a Jew and all these things, I think there's a problem because what many people need is the living water.
Amen.
Ellen White says, Christ combined the two types. He is the rock and he is the living water. The same beautiful and expressive figures are carried about throughout the Bible. Centuries before the advent of Christ, Moses pointed to him as the rock of Israel, salvation. The psalmist sung, Song of him as my redeemer, the rock of my strength, the rock that is higher than I, the rock of habitation, rock of my heart, rock of my refuge. In David's song, his grace is pictured also as the cool, still water and green pastures, beside whom the heavenly shepherd leads his flock again. Thou makest them, he says, drink of the river of thy pleasures. For with thee is the fountain of life, and the wise man declared, well springing of wisdom as flowing brook. To Jeremiah, Christ is the foundation of living waters. To Zechariah, a foundation open for and, I'm sorry, for sin and for uncleanliness. That's taken from Patriarchs and Prophets. When we think of this living water, one of the biggest problems we have in the world today is when we think of this living water, the Holy Spirit, many people are deceived. We see people wave their hands and knock down crowds of people, and they say, that's the Holy Spirit. We see people rolling around on the floor, and they say, he's filled with the Spirit. We see people speaking in languages that nobody can understand, and they say, that's the Spirit. I remember when I used to attend a Pentecostal church, nothing against Pentecostals, but I remember seeing something that amazed me, this lady who could barely walk, and she would come in, and when the drums started playing, and the saxophone started playing, and the guitar started playing, this woman would move like a teenager. But after the music stopped, and the drums stopped, she could hardly move. And I questioned, wow, how come God can't use her on a daily basis to move like a teenager? Something is wrong. God is trying to give us the living water, but the enemy is giving us a false interpretation of the living water. Mm-hmm. Jesus offers something to this woman that no one else could offer, not the Pharisees, not the Sadducees, not the disciples, not anyone, not even family members. Only Jesus could offer this water. And only he can offer this to us today. As Jesus continued in the conversation, he began to get into this woman's business. I remember when I was a young student, and they asked me to go preach at a nursing home, and I began to preach. I was young, I was green, I didn't know that. I didn't know better, any better. And so I was doing the best I could, like I'm doing now. And I went on and I began to preach, and when I finished, they came up to me at the end, these elderly people, and they shook my hand, and one elderly woman came up to me, and she said, I enjoyed your sermon, but then you went to meddling. And so she was saying, in other words, she was saying, you just got in my business. Jesus gets into this woman's business, and he begins to pry into her business. And in verse 17, it says, the woman answered and said, I have no husband. And Jesus says to her, thou hast well said, I have no husband. But in verse 18, he says, for thou hast five husbands. Jesus gets into her business. And the only way he gets into her business is because he opened the door for the conversation. He whom thou hast is not thy husband. So now she had how many husbands?
Six.
Six husbands. Notice it says, this is not your husband. So is that implying that that was somebody else's husband? Now you understand why she needed the living water? So you see, she was a captive. She's in Samaria. She's practicing a Jewish religion. She's also practicing the other religion. There's confusion going on in her life and in her mind. She needs living water. And what does the living water do for us? Brings us truth. Her situation was in bad shape. Five husbands. She was on number six. And if she didn't meet Jesus, she probably would have went to 7 and 8 and 9 and 10. The culture of the Samaritans was horrible. And the culture of the Samaritans is similar to our culture. You know what's kind of shocking? When you look at this, some people would come down on this woman. But when we look at Solomon and David, who's worse? It says, our father worship in this mountain. And ye say, and then she continued in the conversation. But I'm looking at my time and see that we're going to have to close. But, you know, as she continues in the conversation, you notice something about this woman. Jesus continues in the conversation. He reveals these things to her. And then she gets into worship. And Jesus says something that was key here. He says in verse 21, verse 20. Let's go to verse 20. It says, "Our father worship in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Jesus saith unto her, Woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father." So where would she be worshiping the Father? Everywhere, in spirit and in truth.
Amen.
Some people today feel like they have to go to Israel to worship the Father, or a mountain to worship the Father, or in the desert to worship the Father. But God says, you can worship me anywhere in spirit and in truth. It says here in 24, God is a spirit, and they that worship him in spirit and in truth. When we think about the Jews in scripture, Jesus defines who the Jew is. Who is a Jew? Inwardly, not outwardly. You may be circumcised and all these things, but that doesn't make you a Jew according to the definition of Jew in the New Testament. The Jew is who? Those who are inwardly, those who are have allowed God to come into their hearts and change their life. We need the Holy Spirit. I'm going to close. Truth and error and truth and lies will never bring peace and safety to any living soul. You can't mix the two together. And what the Holy Spirit does, it comes in and separates the error, and all you have is truth. God wants his people to have truth and truth alone. The living waters is the Holy Spirit. The world needs the Holy Spirit. The church needs the Holy Spirit. And without the Holy Spirit, there is no salvation. It is the way. Only the Holy Spirit can lead you to salvation. And I repeatedly say that the Holy Spirit will never lead you into sin. And that's absolutely true. Absolutely true. I'm going to finish with this quote. The promise of the Holy Spirit is not limited to any age or any race. This is from Ellen White, Acts of the Apostles, page 49 and 2. Christ declares that the divine influence of his Spirit was to be with his followers until the end. From the day of Pentecost to the present time, the Comforter has been sent to all who have yielded themselves fully to the Lord and to his service, to all who have accepted Christ as personal Savior. They are those today who profess to be God's people and have not accepted Christ as their personal Savior. They are those that call themselves by his name and they are still looking for Messiah. Messiah has come. He has died. He is risen. And they're still looking for Messiah. I'm going to close with these last four sentences. The more closely believers have walked with God, the more clearly and powerfully have they testified of their Redeemer's love and of his saving grace. The men and women who, through the long centuries of persecution and trial, enjoy a large measure of the presence of the Spirit in their lives. So don't get upset when you're battling with stuff. She says, have stood as signs and wonders in the world. Before angels and men, they have revealed the transforming power of the Redeemer's love. God's people need the Spirit. If you're a Jew, you need the Spirit. If you're a Christian and Catholic, whatever you are, all of humanity needs God's Spirit.
Amen.
They need living water. Without living water, we are dehydrated Christians that are dying. Amen. God wants us to partake of his Spirit. He wants us to search these scriptures. He wants us to know what's truth. And when truth comes, we can't push the living water away.
Amen.
I know I got to close, but There are so many who know the truth, and they allow their own opinion to get in the way. And God says, don't do that. Don't do that. Don't do that. Let us bow heads. I'm sorry, she's going to come and play. You know.
Let's turn our hymnals to hymn number 493, Fill My Cup, Lord. This is a prayer song. Let us stand together as we sing the first and third stanzas.
Like the woman at the well, I was seeking for things that could not satisfy. And then I heard my Savior speaking, draw from my well that never shall run dry. Fill my cup, Lord, I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench the thirsting of my soul. Bread
Father in heaven, we thank you. We thank you so much for allowing us to see that we need our cups filled, and not only us. You have called us. We're not here by accident. You have called us to help others to get their cups filled. Father, help us to see through all the lies and the disinformation. Help us to see clearly your way and what you are trying to do for us as not just Adventists, but the world. Help us, Father, to realize and to see that we should pick up your word and study your word and ask you to pour out your spirit upon us so we can understand your word, so that peace may be brought into our lives. Father, the world is offering us peace and safety, but the peace and safety that the world is offering is not peace and safety with you. Lord, help us. Help us to see peace and safety with you, no matter what it costs us, Lord. Help us to do so. Give us the power to stand. This is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated for a moment of quiet meditation.